Think back to your high school history class. Wait, did you even go to high school? You know what? Forget it. I don't want to argue, nor do I want you to punch me in the face. So I'll just catch you up to speed on some stuff I'm sure you already know. The Lost Colony of Roanoke was a British colony off the coast of what we now call North Carolina. As the name implies, it disappeared. Okay? The colony, not the island. 115 people just whoosh, gone. Okay? Goodbye. To this day, no one knows what happened to them. Well, no one except for me and every other supernatural junkie on the planet. See, the darkness was first carried to North America by one of the colonists. And where the darkness goes, its enemies follow. One of those enemies, the Angelus, came to a nearby tribe of Croatoan natives. Influenced by the Angelus, a Croatoan maid slipped into the colony under cloak of night and massacred the colonists in their sleep. This is the weapon she used, Roanoke's Bane. But the Angelus had been mistaken. The darkness was not in Roanoke, as it was being carried by the colony's leader, John White. John was back in England, procuring more supplies. When he returned to find Roanoke deserted, the darkness knew the Angelus had been there. Unfortunately for the Croatoans, the Angelus had already moved on. They were defenseless when the darkness fell upon them, much like the colonists had been. Fair's fair, I suppose. This one's a little tricky. You know the story of Noah and the Great Flood, right? Mm? Okay, humanity grows wicked, God floods the planet, family survives in floating zoo, classic Sunday school. Well, here's what really happened. As you know, the darkness feeds on human suffering. Well, let me tell you, if you think life sucks today, imagine how bad it was back then, before indoor plumbing. The darkness was at an all-you-can-eat smorgasbord of pain, and every meal was making it stronger. Seeing as the Angelus was indisposed at the time, God decided to step in with one of his great ideas. Noah builds the ark, God floods the earth. 99.9% of mankind dies a horrible death. Darkness is destroyed. Huzzah! But did that happen? No, sir! Guess who was waiting once the world has dried off? That's right, needless to say, the Almighty had a little egg on his face. According to legend, God breathed his remorse into the first seashell that Noah found once he left the ark. That shell became known as Yahweh's Lament. I know, it's a different spelling, it's missing some letters. Place it to your ear and you will hear the voice of God. That said, only the truly mad or the nearly dead can fathom God's almighty words. Which is kind of scary, seeing as how I think I can hear something whispering to me right now. Okay, I'm not gonna think about that right now. Anyway, that's the deal with this thing. It's either Yahweh's Lament or it's a seashell. The world may never know. Oh, wow. You seriously have a copy of the True Revelation? I'm impressed, Jackie. Didn't peg you as the reading type. To call this book rare would be laughable. Magic swords, true love, stake. These things are rare. The True Revelation is one of a kind. I'm not exaggerating. Every copy is completely different. See, the True Revelation is actually the Revelation of John, the Bible's explosive summer blockbustering finale. There are three schools of thought about the Revelation. The first believes it is a literal prophecy. This is retarded! The second believes it's a metaphor for Roman persecution. Plausible, but boring. The third believes it is a code that, once deciphered, will reveal the true revelation. People who believe this tend to be insane, but also extremely fun at parties. Now, everyone deciphers the revelation differently, which is why each copy is entirely unique. Just flipping through this one, it appears to have been deciphered by the Brotherhood. In fact, it predicts the Brotherhood's descent into Crazy Town. That means this is a relatively true revelation. See, we can prove the Brotherhood went crazy, but we can't prove what the revelation predicted. Chances are, the man who wrote this copy only saw what he wanted to see inside the revelation, or he was insane and just poured his depravity onto the page. Like they say, write what you know. Either way, this translation has probably guided the Brotherhood's actions for at least a century. Kind of like the normal Bible still does today, hmm? Almost makes you wonder who's crazier. You know, Jackie, you bring me the nicest things. Your methods could be a little less mass murdery, but who am I to argue? Anyway, you wanted to know about this piece. It looks like a panel from the Metatron Steely, I don't know, we're gonna say steel, okay? Which would be amazing if it weren't impossible. See, the Metatron Steel was carried down from heaven by Enoch, way back at the start of time. This wasn't easy. The steel was a stone slab, carved directly from the seed of creation. On it was inscribed every revelation Enoch witnessed in heaven. The amount of knowledge contained on just an inch of this thing would shatter our every notion of creation. So, of course, someone fucking lost it. Lucky for us, someone else was smart enough to copy it. Well, parts of it. This is one of those parts. It's called the Sister of Light, and it's pretty important, at least concerning you. Think back to Genesis. There were only two things in the beginning, light and dark. The Bible says God separated the two, turning light into day and darkness into night. But in actuality, the darkness just stayed the darkness, and the light became the Angelus, or, as it was once known, the Sister of Light. What is the Angelus? Well, not to bum you out, but according to legend, it's your other half, Jackie, and all it wants is to rip you open and burn away the darkness. Yeesh. There's just not an easy way to lay them on somebody. See this sexy guy right here? This is the Dark Man. As you can tell by the cute little demon heads on either side, the Dark Man was one of your predecessors. In fact, he's the first darkness host we have any record of. We know there have been hosts before him, but none of them got statues, so fuck them. You know? No one knows who the Dark Man was or where he came from. All we have to go on is one passage from the Hidden Testament of Moses. If I can paraphrase, it says, he walked out of the wilderness, a dark man who spoke with authority. You know, like James Earl Jones. And those words were black, even the wisest were swayed. Cue 40 years of horror unlike anything the world had ever seen. Oh yeah, you heard that correctly. 40 fucking years. Moses wasn't lost in the desert for 4 decades. He was fighting a war against Mr. Tall, Dark, and Stretchy. Seriously, I mean, what's up with this guy's neck? He's like a giraffe. Anyway, what were we talking about? Oh, the 40-year war, 40-year war. Before the war had ended, the Dark Man had eaten Moses' heart, which is the real reason Moses never saw the Promised Land. It's also probably why the Dark Man got a statue. I mean, killing Moses is a pretty big deal, historically speaking. Whoa, hold up. Whoa, whatever you do, for the love of God, don't ever let that blade touch your skin. I mean, what do you think you're doing bringing that here? Well, okay, yes, this is your house, so I guess you can do whatever the fuck you want. But remember, I'm here to help you figure if what you want to do is actually something you don't want to do. Trust me when I say, using that knife falls into the latter category. That's a Furba, which on its own is dangerous enough to a guy like you. A Furba's blade will pin a demon to the spot. Once that's done, only the person who shanked the demon can free it. Now, it is possible that a normal Furba wouldn't be strong enough to bind you. But this is the Trinity. Its blade was forged from the 3 nails that crucified Christ. Not normal! Extremely not normal! If you'd cut yourself with the Trinity, you would have been paralyzed. The only person who could have set you free would have been you, which you wouldn't be able to do because you would be paralyzed. Do you see the paradox here? Come to think of it, you ever decide to touch this stuff, just ask first. All right, nothing big, just a simple, hey, Johnny, is it okay if I touch this? And I'll say, sure, Jackie. That absolutely will not trap you in a never-ending loop of torment. Or I'll say the other thing. You know, no. Okay, so you know the story of the Ten Commandments, right? Of course you do. Okay, Moses went up a mountain to receive God's law. When he came back down, Moses found his people worshiping a new god, the golden cow. But they didn't call it the golden cow. It had a name. But legend says God struck it from man's tongue, never to be uttered again. Nowadays, we just call it the graven image. Well, Moses was pissed, obviously, so he disbanded this little cow cult. Some of his people, being of a progressive mindset, were like, hey, what about freedom of religion, man? To which I assume Moses responded, you're kidding, right? But they weren't. So, led by their high priestess, these, we'll call them Calvinists, left Moses and went into the desert to worship their graven image. It was there, according to legend, that the Calvinists met a dark man. You can probably guess where this is going. The dark man claimed to speak for the graven image. He said it demanded sacrifice, human sacrifice. These weren't the smartest people. So, it wasn't long before they were cutting out each other's hearts. When they got around to sacrificing the high priestess, she was understandably not too keen on the idea. So, to save her holy ass, she repented to the god of Moses. Surprisingly, this worked. The Angelus descended upon the altar, possessing the body of the high priestess. The dark man escaped. The people didn't. Okay, I'm looking at this and what I'm seeing is the chime of deliverance. But, and mind you, this is a small but. All records of the chime say it was destroyed along with Solomon's temple back in 586 BC. That said, records have been wrong in the past, so who knows? Maybe it's the real thing. The chime first dates back to the 40-year war, that period of time when Moses and the Israelites fought the darkness in the wilderness. The chime wasn't designed to be a weapon. Instead, it was an instrument of safe passage. According to the secret histories, the chime was carried ahead of Moses' army and struck every 153 steps. Now, any army in history would tell you that ringing a bell nonstop is a bad idea. That's how your enemy finds you. Thing is, the darkness is no ordinary enemy, and the chime is no ordinary bell. You're in the mob. The mob is Italian. Italian's like opera, right? Well, you know how an opera singer can shatter glass by singing a certain note? Well, the chime of deliverance does the same thing. Except instead of glass, it shatters darkness. The exact pitch has never been identified, but when struck, the chime emits a sound that can physically push back the night. Now, if you want, we can test the chime's authenticity. We just gotta hit it, you know, make it sing. But, and this is a much larger butt. A butt of epic proportions, really. It might disintegrate you. Just saying. I gotta say, I'm a little disappointed. I've waited years to see one of these. 7 years, if we're being honest, and it is not living up to my expectations. You gotta understand, only 12 of these masks were ever made. This is probably the only one still in existence. That's already enough to mark this thing as priceless. But it doesn't stop there. No, sir. These masks were forged by a group of monks known as the Brothers of Men. And we're not talking about run-of-the-mill pacifist monks. The Brothers of Men were hardcore, ass-kicking warrior priests. It was in China, after the fall of the Han Dynasty. The darkness was living in Shu Han, feeding off the War of the Three Kingdoms. Legend suggests that the Angelus appeared to the monks, warning them of the darkness. It doesn't say why the Angelus didn't fight the darkness herself, but it doesn't matter, because the monks, they handled themselves just fine. The monks single-handedly defeated the darkness, using nothing but their fists and these masks. It said that if a mass caught even the smallest light from the dimmest candle, it would be reflected back 100-fold. The monks were basically walking sunbeams, which sounds goofy when I say it like that, but still. I'm just disappointed to see its magic is long gone. I'm killed to see it in action. Well, not kill, since I guess I'd have to use it on you, and that would be just awkward. You know, the darkness didn't come from the cradle of civilization. The darkness came from nowhere. Which, if you follow the Rothfusian or Rothfussian, I say Rothfussian, okay? Theory, it means the darkness also comes from everywhere. Numerous cultures throughout history make reference to the darkness, even though most of them had never encountered it. For example, take a look at this Aztec totem. An anthropologist would identify it as the key of Mictlan. Mictlan, of course, being the Aztec underworld. This is wrong on an absurd number of levels. Mictlan was a battleground that fed on the souls of the dead. Man, woman, child, didn't matter. They went on to their death prepared to fight, knowing that Mictlan awaited them. Sound familiar to you? It should! It's the darkness! This is just one example out of thousands. Every person since the dawn of time has known instinctually the darkness was waiting. It's why so many of us have a natural fear of the dark. To me, that says something, and I don't think you're gonna like it. Part of me believes the darkness is inside all of us. Just a small bit of essence. It's a part of us. Maybe the darkness came from us. Maybe it's an extension of who we are. I don't know! But I do know that if any of those crazy ideas are even partly true, then the darkness isn't going anywhere, no matter what we do. I wonder what's on TV tonight. This is, well, it's a thumbscrew. I don't really know what else to tell you. I mean, this thing is definitely giving off dark energy. But again, we're talking about a device that was used to torture people by slowly crushing their fingers. I'd be scared if it wasn't giving off nasty vibes. What? You want more? Sure. Just give me a second. Okay, I got something. From what I can divine, this thing goes back like 400 years. It was used on a host who was imprisoned by the Brotherhood. Chances are that dark energy I'm picking up is a taint left by the darkness. Meaning this isn't just any thumbscrew, it's an evil thumbscrew, so it hurts more. Maybe. Oh, that's still not enough. Okay, fine. This is the infamous Black Thumb! In 1631, it single-handedly ripped and raped its way across the English countryside, leaving behind a trail of bloody bastards and broken dreams. Never has the world seen such carnage. Pray it never will again. Yes, I am being sarcastic. No, I don't want you to kill me. Okay, I'll shut up. You know, Jackie, this thing inside of you, the darkness, to you, it's a curse. But not everyone sees it that way. It's like that old saying, one man's curse is another man's... Gimme! You know, I mean, that's a stupid way to think, obviously. The darkness is the possessor, not the possession. But stupid people do stupid things, which is why many of them have tried to steal the darkness over the years. Lucky for you, I guess, these attempts usually don't go very far. Take this relic, for instance. Over time, it has earned the name the Fool's Phylactery. If you ever played D&D as a kid... Looking at your muscles, I will assume you did not. You'd know that a phylactery is like a Tupperware for souls. It keeps them safe, fresh, unspoiled. It also doesn't fucking exist! Nowhere in all the black arts is there such a thing as a phylactery. See, the Fool's Phylactery is a hoax perpetrated by a monk back in the 1600s. He'd had his fill of religion and was looking to cash out, so he crafted this fancy container, forged some ancient scrolls, you know, then sold it to the first rube he could find. That idiot tried to catch the darkness and got eaten instead. You'd think that would be the end of it, but no! 400 years and countless dead later, this shit is still going on! People are fucking idiots! This is why I live in a box, under a bridge. What you're holding is the very first artistic interpretation of the darkness. Or as it was known then, He Who Comes with the Night. Not the catchiest of names, but pretty good when you consider that most people are still living in caves. Anyway, at this point in history, Cain, you know, Adam's son, as in the Garden of Eden, first guy to ever walk the earth, Adam, had dealt with most of the demons and assorted nasties that still roam the world. But no one had faced the darkness yet. See, God protected Cain from the darkness by making him unkillable. It was a great plan. If you happen to be Cain, everyone else, not so much. Murder didn't stop just because Cain ran out of brothers to bludgeon, so the darkness still had plenty of souls to latch onto. Some legends suggest the darkness was first carried by a son of Lilith. Others say it was a Nephilim, but I don't buy that one. We'd all be dead if that was the case. Not that it matters. Okay, whoever it was, through him, the darkness raped, ravaged, and generally fucked things up. Only the Angelus had the power to face the darkness. All Cain could do was warn people. So he sculpted 12 of these statues, entrusting them to 12 holy men. They carried these statues across the land, spreading word of He Who Comes with the Night. But the darkness did not want to be known. Within a year, it had devoured all 12 of them. The statues were gone, shattered, or lost to time. Well, until now, apparently. You know, this isn't the first time the Brotherhood has tried to take the darkness. Yeah, things look bleak right now, but believe it or not, they've done worse. A lot worse. It was a long time ago. So far back, no one knew the Brotherhood even existed. They'd been around, but necessity required they keep a low profile. See, they were watching the darkness, studying it, learning what made it tick. They already knew enough not to fuck with the darkness. So if they were gonna move against it, they needed to be totally confident in their knowledge. I have to give them credit. The Brotherhood knew what they were doing. They accurately predicted who the next host would be. Swapping children at birth, they raised the host as one of their own. Then, when he came of age, they chained him to a table and tortured him to death. This is the Blinding Sun. One of these was inserted into each of his eye sockets, gouging out each eye in the process. Each device was then slowly expanded until it shattered his forehead and cheekbones. This was the first of 12 tortures. The darkness didn't manifest itself until the fourth. That means it took 2 more of these unspeakable acts before the Brotherhood could be certain they had the right guy. That doubt didn't even slow them down. These are bad people, Jackie, and they have it in them to be a whole lot worse. I don't know if you've looked inside this box, but the ashes in here? Yeah, definitely a dead guy. In fact, I think this dead guy used to be Cain. You know, first son of Adam and Eve, formerly of Cain and Abel, that guy, that guy. Now, there are 2 theories about what happened to Cain. The first claims that he married his sister and built a house, where they lived until the day it collapsed, killing him. And honestly, that's so fucking boring I almost believe it. The second theory, however, claims Cain wandered the world for 100 years. See, God had set him on a path of atonement. So, alone, armed with nothing but his murder stick, Cain fought to rid our world of darkness. And by all accounts, he was pretty good at it. Not that I'm surprised, I mean, this is the guy who invented murder, fratricide, and hate crime all in one go. Obviously, he had talent. But talent won't get you very far against the darkness. Cain had heard of a woman called the Sister of Light. We know her as the Angelus. Cain tracked her down, seeking an ally against the darkness. Thing is, the Angelus is one nasty bitch. Real stickler for the rules. 100 years couldn't remove the stench of Abel's blood, so when the Angelus got a whiff of Cain, she burned him on the spot. Seeing as how I'm holding a box of his ashes, I'm inclined to believe the second theory. Jackie, let me introduce you to Enoch, great-great-great-great-grandson of Adam, great-grandfather to Noah, and the only guy who knows how many angels can dance on the head of a pin. I'm sure he'd say hi, but as you can see, he's dead. Enoch's a special guy. If not for him, we'd only know a teeny-tiny little smidgen of what we do about heaven, hell, and all those weebly-wobbly bits in between. How'd he learn all this stuff? Well, if you read the Bible, it says that Enoch walked with God. What does that mean? Fuck if I know! I don't know, the Bible doesn't say, it just says, poof, no more Enoch, next verse. This is why I don't read the Bible. I do, however, read the secret history. And it's there that we learn Enoch actually ascended to heaven, where he apparently took some night classes, because the next time we see him, he's back on Earth, busy being the world's foremost expert on all things occult and supernatural. Do you know how many other people have been invited to heaven just for a visit? 0! Seriously, they loved him up there! So much, in fact, that upon his death, a heavenly host descended from the clouds simply to inscribe his skull with the language of angels. That's the markings you see. No one has ever been able to decipher them, but when the skull is placed in absolute darkness, the markings emit a faint singing noise, which is kind of a cool thing. I hope you're not in a good mood, because if you are, I promise this is gonna shit all over it. This is the Lantern of St. Anthony, possibly the most misidentified item ever created. I don't mean people look at this lamp and say, that is a very luminescent club sandwich. What I mean is, most people see this lantern as a symbol of hope, but really, it's a symbol of soul-crushing despair. Now, the outer casing is only 80 years old, but the light inside the lantern goes back, about 1,000 years. In her war against the darkness, the Angelus sought an ever-burning light. She gathered the souls of 100 children butchered by the darkness, and bound them within a glass sphere. This combined lightness of being produced a blindingly powerful light, but only when the dead children felt like it. Turns out kids are fickle little bitches. The Angelus abandoned the sphere, totally apathetic towards the children still trapped inside. The sphere remained lost for quite some time until it was discovered by St. Anthony, the patron saint of lost things. Go figure! Anthony fastened it onto a lantern, believing it to be a gift from God. He was convinced the light would guide a traveler home, but usually it just led them over a cliff or into a bog. So yeah, St. Anthony used this lantern to unknowingly kill hundreds of innocent travelers, all because the Angelus thought the imprisoned souls of murdered children would make a cool weapon. Yay! Okay. Jeez. First off, holy shit! Second, do you know what these are? These are Af and Hema. That ring any bells? No? Okay, well then let me put it this way. There are 6 angels of death. You are currently holding 2 of them. Yeah. Okay, their names are Af and Hema, roughly. They translate to wrath and anger. It was on the 7th level of heaven that God bound Af and Hema with chains of fire and shadow, which was no small feat, mind you. These weren't your run-of-the-mill chubby cherubs, you know. The Af and Hema were roughly the size of a large volcano and packed 10 times the firepower, alright? Then again, God being God, you know, I guess it wasn't really a fair fight, but whatever, I'm getting off topic, okay? As the story goes, the Angelus asked God for a weapon to aid her war against the darkness. God was in a giving mood that day, so he reforged Af and Hema into the flames of creation, all right? Tempering them down into blades. These blades, these right here. Now, some say the angels are still alive within the blades, and I tend to agree. Try all you like, but you can't separate them. Try taking only one of them out of this room. It might slip out of your hand, or you might just drop dead of a stroke. Now, you never know, but they will not be parted. We're talking peanut butter and jelly. Ham and cheese level of commitment here, man. Somewhere, somehow, Af and Hema are still bound by the chains of fire and shadow. Now this, oh yeah, this is the good stuff. The Abysmal Maw. Dark magic at its sexiest. Jeez, I'm getting hot just looking at it. The Abysmal Maw, or the Mawsome, as I like to call it, was carved directly from the gates of hell. Grip it in your right hand, then say the magic words, and the maw will unleash a blast of pure hellfire. Do you know what hellfire does? It destroys everything! And everything it destroys goes straight to hell. You could have killed Mother Teresa with this, and she even would have burned for eternity. Thing is, every time you use the maw, it burns away part of your soul as well. Most people only get 3 or 4 blasts before they wake up in hell. Theoretically, a darkness host could probably use it ad nauseum, you know, since your soul is already kinda in hell. Unfortunately, the maw no longer works because someone misplaced the magic words. Records show the Brotherhood were the last users of the maw, sometime around World War II. That means it's their fault that the world is far less awesome than it used to be. It almost makes me want to cry! You know, maybe next time before you tear 5 or 10 of them apart, you could, I don't know, ask if they remember the words? Ah, the crescent of the sun, considered by many to be the greatest mystery and biggest letdown of the past millennium. You know, if you don't count Rocky V. The crescent was wielded by the Angelus approximately 800 years ago for half an hour. She claimed it was forged from a single drop of the sun's flame, that it would bring about the final end of the darkness. What she forgot to mention, however, is how the crescent would do this, which is important because she never got a chance to use it. Carrying it into battle against the darkness, she was immediately disemboweled. A bit anticlimactic for sure, but it only gets worse. A few years later, the crescent was rediscovered by a holy warrior. Once again, the blade was wielded against the darkness. This time, it even managed to get a few good swings. But you know what? The blade passed through the darkness, like a knife through water. Later, after monks recovered the crescent from the warrior's corpse, it was tested against multiple targets. Turns out the blade passes through all matter. People, stone, trees, kittens, just whoosh, goes right through. No harm, no foul. Could be only the Angelus can wield the crescent, but if so, why has she never tried to reclaim it? Personally, I think the Angelus talked a big game. It was just as surprised as everyone else when the crescent turned out to be worthless, which begs the question, where did the crescent come from? I got no idea, but I hope she kept the receipt. Okay, Jackie, time for a quick history lesson. Buddhism was founded by Siddhartha Gautama. I don't even know if that's the right pronunciation, just go with it. Siddhartha led an extraordinary life, but for our purposes, his death is what's important. History says Siddhartha announced his imminent death at the age of 80. Immediately after making this announcement, he ate his last meal. It was an offering made by a blacksmith. Siddhartha then became ill and died. Obviously, there was more to it, but I'm not here to teach religion 101. Those are the main points. Before dying, Siddhartha made sure his followers knew that the blacksmith had nothing to do with his death, because, from all accounts, Siddhartha was a pretty stand-up guy. Unfortunately, he was way off on this one. The blacksmith totally poisoned him. And that's not all. He also gave Siddhartha water from his pitcher. This pitcher. As you can guess, this is no normal pitcher. This pitcher works like a soul pump. Drinking out of it creates a mystical vacuum inside the jar. Stop drinking, and your soul is whooshed into the clay, where it remains until the magic is broken. The magic on this relic is unbelievably strong. It's held for over 2,000 years. And that's why this relic has earned the name Siddhartha's Tears, because Siddhartha is still trapped inside. Who'd do such a thing to such a nice guy like Siddhartha? I think you already know. The darkness is the enemy of peace and unity. Its wrath is not always violent, but it is cold and unyielding. Just like Siddhartha's tears. Or the Red Sox. Ew. Oh, you feel that? This thing's hidden an 11 out of 10 on my creepy meter. Just being near it, it feels like I got worms under my skin. Worms that are creeped out as I am because they got worms under their skin. Am I painting a clear enough picture? You may look at this and see an iron mask. Just a common torture device used to humiliate someone. It didn't cause any physical pain. It was just a symbol. If a person was dirty, their mask looked like a pig. If they fucked around, it looked like something that fucked around. I don't know, a rabbit. Okay, now if you look closely at this mask, you'll see it kind of looks like a demon. Makes sense since it was worn by a former darkness host. Maybe you heard of him? Vlad the Impaler, better known as Dracula. Not many people can claim they were the source material for a famous monster. In fact, I only know of two. This guy and Helen Keller. What you don't realize is that this mask isn't creepy because Vlad wore it. It's creepy because he wore it voluntarily. He wanted everyone to know exactly who was coming to impale them on a giant fucking spike. And just to add insult to an insanely painful mortal injury, do you know what he named his mask? The Mark of Cain. As if to say, that's right, bitches, I'm unkillable. This might be the most fashionable fuck you in the history of man. Oh, you'll appreciate this, being a former altar boy and all, I assume. And this is the head of Pope John the 12th. Well, shrunken head. At least, I hope it's been shrunk. If not, then I imagine he had trouble wearing his Pope hat. Anyways, turns out Lil John here was the only Darkness host to ever become Pope, which would explain why he's considered one of the worst popes of all time, though, ironically, not one of the worst hosts. You'd think the Darkness would have used the papacy to run rampant, but honestly, John the 12th spent most of his time disemboweling his deacons and boning up on the ladies. Actually, never mind. Now that I think about it, he did summon a few not-so-minor lust demons into the Vatican, then turned it into a brothel. And by brothel, I mean charnel house, a.k.a. place where dead bodies are dug up and stored after their graves are more or less desecrated. So, yeah, Pope John the 12th was a huge dick, in more ways than one. Small side note, I have it on good authority that three of those demons are still around doing their thing. So, do yourself a favor and never take a naked tour of the Sistine Chapel. Not that they offer one, still, just do it. Listen, I'm gonna tell you about this particular relic, but you gotta promise me something. No matter what I tell you, you can't let this get weird, okay? Okay? This is the reliquary of the Blessed Blood. It is said to contain a relic of untold worth, an object of unfathomable holiness, a preserved piece of flesh from the Messiah himself. Yes, that's right. We're talking about the foreskin of Jesus Christ. Except, here's the thing. There is someone's foreskin inside this reliquary. It just didn't belong to the holy member. It actually belonged to a guy named Miles from South Hamingtonshire. Don't ask how I know this. I just do. I'm an occultist, all right? Just forget about the foreskin. The foreskin is a distraction. There was nothing important about the foreskin, and we should both just forget it ever happened. Moving on. The container is what's so important here, okay? See, the Darkness isn't the only power the Brotherhood wants to harness. They're just as interested in the Angelus. This reliquary was their first attempt to create a vessel that could hold the Angelus. It was a total failure. All it did was piss off the Angelus, and when she's pissed, she does like to burn things. Still, there's dark magic in here. Magic best hidden from certain people. And turning it into an impossibly ridiculous foreskin holder was a good way to do that. Now, if you'll excuse me, I need to go scrub my memory with bleach and steel wool. You can't tell by looking at it, but this simple strip of iron is one of the worst torture devices ever devised. It's one of the 12 infamous purification rituals used by the Brotherhood the first time they ever tried to steal the Darkness. The Brotherhood simply referred to it as the Fourth, but over time it earned the name the Silent Night. It's easy to see why. Long time ago, the Brotherhood stole a Darkness host at birth. They then raised him as one of their own, only to torture and kill him in an attempt to force the Darkness out. This strip was forced into that unfortunate host's mouth, keeping it open. It was then wrapped around his jaw, leaving a slit where his tongue was inserted. The gag was then slowly tightened. The first thing it did was slice off the host's tongue. But then the gag was tightened further, and it completely shattered and dislocated his jaw. You think that's horrible? Keep in mind, the host had yet to manifest the Darkness. He didn't know what he was. The Brotherhood had raised him since birth to believe he was one of their own. Imagine, the only family you've ever known subjecting you to the most painful, degrading acts they can imagine, and they don't even tell you why. I don't want to sound like I'm going soft, but it seems to me like that'd be the worst torture of all. Anyway, the Darkness manifested right as the host's jaw snapped. They say it killed every person within a league of the Brotherhood's monastery that day. Then, the host vanished, never to be seen again. Now, we don't even know his name. Ooh, the Deceiver's Grasp. The third most infamous glove of all time, right behind the sparkly one and the one that didn't fit. And the Deceiver's Grasp was designed to be used in conjunction with the Abysmal Maw. If you don't know, the Maw was a mystical hand cannon that shot pure hellfire, but consumed the user's soul in the process. It only took a few thousand damnings before someone got the idea to protect themselves from the Maw's side effects, and so the Deceiver's Grasp was forged as a sort of damnation contraceptive for your hand. Current theory holds that the Brotherhood created the glove, which would make sense, since it employs a rather nasty bit of transference magic. See, when laced with the blood of another living person, the glove allows you to wield the Maw without having your soul burnt away, whereas the poor sap whose blood you used will spend eternity cozied up beside the fires of hell. Come to think of it, a better name for this thing would have been the asshole's bait and switch, or my slimy brother Ted. It doesn't sound as ominous, I admit, but it's just so damn accurate. Wow, okay, shit, where do I start? What you got here is the First. As you can guess by its name, this thing goes way back, like way back to the beginning. You're a good Catholic boy, so I know you remember the story of Cain and Abel, how Abel was like, oh, God loves me, and Cain was like, jealousy, wham, and killed him. But this, that's right, you're the new proud owner of Murder Stick number one, so congrats, I guess. Now, the story goes that God was so pissed that he marked Cain, set him walking the earth forever, unable to die. But that's only half true. See, Cain brought murder into our world, back in when it was, still new and teeming with free-range evil. This made him a target for certain dark influences, if you catch my emphasis. Even if Cain was a brother-murdering jackass, God wasn't gonna let the darkness run a train on him. So, he made Cain unkillable. As you know, the darkness deals in death. If Cain couldn't die, the darkness couldn't take him. Not a bad move on God's part. But God doesn't just hand out free prizes, especially for murdering your brother. So, he set Cain to a task, cleaning up all that leftover darkness from before creation. Unfortunately for Cain, unkillable did not mean immortal, but that's a different story altogether. You want to know how the Brotherhood got to be the fun-loving psychos they are today? It's all thanks to you. Well, thanks to the darkness. There was one time, only one time, that the Brotherhood succeeded in trapping the darkness, and it drove them insane. The darkness is not to be fucked with, and even when in prison, it is a force to be reckoned with. For decades, the Brotherhood watched over the siphon, the darkness stirring within it, perverting their minds. It wasn't long before the Brotherhood decided the only way to save the world was to destroy it. Gee, wonder who gave them that idea. There was one brother who stood firm against the taint. No, not that kind of taint. Get your mind out of the gutter. Focus! His faith was so ironclad, the darkness couldn't touch him. When he learned what his fellow brothers planned to do, he knew there was only one option. He set the darkness free. Now, this didn't make the Angelus happy. No, she returned to the earth just so she could deliver the granddaddy of all smitings. That one faithful brother was reduced to ash just moments after he'd saved the world. The Angelus's rage burned so hot, it consumed the brother's soul entirely. He stopped the Brotherhood from destroying all creation, and in return, he became the first human to ever meet non-existence. In all of heaven and earth, the only thing left of him are these ashes. The ashes of the unnamed. Kinda lends credence to that saying, no good deed goes unpunished. Holy shit, Jackie, this is big. This is really big. You know how the siphon of the Angelus was designed to hold the darkness? Well, this is the prism of the brothers, and it's meant to hold the Angelus. After the darkness escaped the siphon, the Brotherhood vanished for a long time. So long, in fact, it was believed that they disbanded. But no, the siphon of the Angelus had been lost to them. Without it, they couldn't make good on their plan to shroud the world in darkness. Instead, they decided to burn the world with light, so they built this. When the darkness in Angelus re-emerged during World War II, the Brotherhood was waiting for them. Don't ask me how, because I sure as hell got no idea, but the Brotherhood defeated the Angelus, trapping her inside the prison. Okay? Where, according to legend, she remains today. Here's the thing, Jackie. I'm looking at this prism right now, and I'm not picking up a thing. No holy essence, no dark magic, nothing! The Angelus is not inside the prism. In fact, it never even touched it. If I can be honest, this scares the living fuck out of me! The Angelus has not been seen on our world in 70 years. We thought it was because she was trapped in this. But she's not, Jackie. She's still out there. Where the fuck is she?